Good afternoon and morning, everyone. My name is Christie MacDonald, and I'm the Marketing Manager for Industry Relations at Realtor.com. Today, we're joined by two outstanding women, both in leadership positions at the MLS and association level, who are willing to share their stories, secrets, and advice with us. Katie, would you like to introduce yourself, where you're from, and any committees or organizations you're currently involved with professionally or personally?
Sure, and thank you so much for having me. I'm honored to be on this panel and with someone as great as Rebecca, so thanks for having me. I'm Katie Schatz. I am honored to be the CEO at the Memphis Area Association of Realtors, and I serve currently on the NAR Leadership Advisory, Volunteer Leadership Advisory Board, past AEI Chair, and I'm also on a board for the City of Memphis, where we actually do pilots and bonds for attainable housing projects.
Rebecca? Uh-oh, we're muted. Hold on one second. Is the microphone green?
There you go. Here we go. How's that?
Perfect.
Oh, thank you. Hey, you're on mute. Sorry. Happy St. Patrick's Day. And thank you so much for inviting me to be part of this discussion. I really enjoyed our prep calls. And so anyway, I'm Rebecca Jensen. I am the CEO of MRED, which is the regional multiple listing service that serves the greater Chicagoland area. So we're working our way down the Illinois state, and then we spill over borders into Indiana and Wisconsin and Iowa and you know, fingers crossed, hopefully growing. So I'm also the board chair of the Real Estate Standards Organization, also known as RESO, also known as REZO. You can pronounce it how you want. And then I'm also the board chair of the MLS Grid and on the board of directors of the Broker Public Portal, which is the organization that brings you Home Snap and the Fair Displayed Guidelines. So anyway, that's me. So thank you.
As we can see, two very involved females, extremely involved. Let's start where it all began. I know if Katie, you don't mind starting, I know your story a little bit better than Rebecca's, but you both have different stories and how you got to where you are. And I think it's inspiring if you don't mind sharing.
Thank you. That gave me chills a little bit. My story is funny because I'm back where I started, which is just amazing. So I'm very lucky, but I started in the Realtor fam right here at MAR in Memphis in 2008, which was very auspicious timing. So I started in January and I started as the events coordinator at MAR, and I knew nothing about Realtor associations. I didn't even know they existed. And, you know, really didn't know anything about real estate. So learned everything I know from being here for 8 years. So I moved up from doing just events to becoming the communications director and then being the staff support for Women's Council, YPN, managing our sponsorship program for our affiliates and managing our commercial council, which we have about 330 pure commercial brokers here in Memphis who do an amazing job. So supported them for several years. So just kept kind of taking things on and never said no. And so that really allowed me to grow a lot and learn a lot of things. And then from there, I felt like I really needed to get out of MAR in Memphis to continue to spread my wings. So I talked to a bunch of my colleagues and from across the country and several of my members actually too, who had connections in other areas. And I really was looking for that next opportunity that would help me continue to build my career. I knew at that point that I really wanted to grow into the AE role at some point. So that was what, you know, I kind of built a business plan to do that. And getting my RCE was part of that and all the steps you take to get your RCE. So I built that out and built out a time frame and studied every weekend and had, you know, note cards and did the whole thing and was really, really intentional about it. And so through, you know, that process, leaving Memphis, it was like, I need the next step in my career. So what's that going to be? It wasn't about where am I moving. It was, I was lucky enough to be in a position where I didn't have at the time of wonderful spouse that I have now, and you know, no attachments besides a little beagle, so we could pick up and go wherever we wanted to go. So I was fortunate to be able to do that. And so the position I found happened to be in beautiful St. Petersburg, Clearwater, Florida. Don't hate me, but I know it didn't hurt at all. I could have gone anywhere, and I ended up picking like heaven on earth, basically. So I was fortunate and had an amazing mentor there, David Bennett. Lots of people know David. He's very progressive, and it's a 9,000 member association. And lots of great things happening in Florida. There's just so many exciting things going on in that state. So I was fortunate enough to end up in Pinellas as David's COO. And it was a perfect opportunity for me to learn from him, but not be in this seat, right? And so I was able to not, you know, have the reward without the risk, I guess. So I really had a great breeding ground there, and was there for about 3 years, I guess. And then I did take a CEO role at a smaller board north of that in Hernando County that had about 800 members, and we had our own MLS. And then Memphis came calling again, which I wasn't expecting at that time. And so I was so lucky to be able to interview for this position and eventually come back. So I've been back. It'll actually be 3 years on the 20th. So in 3 days, it'll be 3 years that I've been back. And it's just been fantastic. But for me, like, I don't think I would have made it back and not be in this seat if it wasn't for the opportunities that I was able to make happen in Florida. So that really helped me grow a lot and have the confidence to be able to be back in Memphis.
Well, it's inspiring. Happy anniversary, by the way, early.
Thank you.
It's inspiring to hear what a community this realtor world is, and the connections, as you said, that led you to the next step and then eventually got you back to MAR. Rebecca, absolutely. I know your story is a little bit different, but it's also inspiring. Can you share with us?
And it's very similar in many aspects to Katie's, because I also worked my way up and through different organizations, and it is a very small community in the organized real estate sphere. So it's funny because you said your mentor was named David. So was one of mine. So David Sharon was one of my mentors that helped me progress my career. I basically started in the MLS industry as a contractor for a training company right in the beginning of like MLS's transitioning from the old platforms into the internet. So I started in 1997, 98 in that capacity as a trainer. And then the MLS in Utah hired me as a help desk person in like the first part of 1998, so many years ago. And I didn't know what an MLS was. I didn't know that much about real estate. I mean, I was very young, didn't own my own home or anything like that at the time. And I very much saw my job as something that would just be a resume fodder, and then I was going to go on to other things. But then I kind of got hooked on, hey, what's happening in MLS and what's going on? And the nice thing about real estate is that there's definitely a play for like technology, and that was mostly what my passion was, is how like this internet thing I was convinced was here to stay. So whew, good thing that
right.
Yeah, well, and then the MLS in Utah was building their own platform from start to finish. And so I got to work with some of the best minds in the industry, like these different vendors coming in, and got to talk to all the realtors out there and learn a ton about how real estate transactions happen, especially over time because it's changed. So there's always a degree of interest in the different problems to be solved. So long story short, I mentioned that the company in Utah built their own software. I ended up getting a computer science degree and a master's degree, and working my way up through the ranks between, you know, training and the tech support phone job, through management into software engineering, into like a CIO position, and then ultimately CEO there. And it was along that time frame that I became involved more in the industry. So that's when I figured out, you know, what is the Real Estate Standards Organization, or RESO, which is a thriving organization today. But back when I got involved, it really was a project within the National Association of Realtors that was charged with creating data standards for all technology. So it still remains an amazing place to go and hear from the actual people that are developing real estate software, you know, not just what they're working on, like all the opportunities that are there, but you know, what are the pain points and how can different organizations fill those pain points? So I got involved in RESO, and then from RESO came other organizations like the MLS Grid, and then Broker Public Portal. Also was in response to just being actively engaged in the real estate community and saying, hey, you know, what is it that brokers want? Sometimes it's technology, sometimes it's not. Sometimes it's, you know, different business rules or philosophies that can be, like molded with different players in the industry. So I came to MRED because of my involvement in those other organizations. So I was actually headhunted by the MRED chairman, who I had reached out to in my capacity as the chairman of, or chairperson, whatever, of RESO. I reached out and he said, hey, there's an opening as the CEO of MRED. Would you be interested in applying? And that's when I reached out to my mentor, David Sharon, and he's like, hey, you know, create the opportunity to say no, because I have my entire family in Utah. It's very difficult to relocate, especially across the country. I didn't know anybody save for this chairman. And my mentor did not steer me wrong. And I created the opportunity to say no. And that meant I met a whole bunch of people here in the Chicagoland area and fell in love. And here we are. So.
And how long have you been at MRED?
Since 2015.
Okay.
So a while.
So you found a home. I love it.
Yeah, I did. It's awesome here. So
that's awesome. Katie, I know last week you were at AEI and you guys were talking a little bit about this and had quite a panel on it. Could you share a little bit with us some insights? We had some great conversation on Tuesday, but I think the rest of the world can benefit from everything that you guys were able to, and that's these connecting events are exactly what we're talking about that get everybody there. And I think it's important that we highlight that.
Yeah, thank you. We had a great meeting. It was our first time together in a couple years. So there was tons of energy and excitement. And we did a session called Weathering AE Storms. So it was about just all the angsty things that happened to us as CEOs and to our leadership and our staff, and kind of working through. Our panel really wanted it to be solutions based and not just, you know, sitting around complaining about things, which isn't very productive. So we kind of walked through some scenarios and some strategies for how to deal with those things. And then there was a workshop portion, and we did a post-secret type thing where we didn't know if people would be comfortable standing up in the room in front of everyone or even at a round table talking about what their situations were. So they could write it on a note card that no one had to know whose it was, whose little secret. And then we read it and worked through the scenarios on stage. So, but we really kind of, in talking through it with the panel, we had a couple of planning sessions for it, and we put everything in kind of three buckets. And so we came up with being able to count on your peers, and being able to count on your members or your leaders, and being able to count on yourself. And it's interesting because I think Rebecca and I both hit on those things in telling our stories, how you so count on the others in the AE or CEO world that you think, we all feel like we're alone sometimes. Like, we started this session by saying it's lonely at the top. And it is, because you have to have boundaries with your staff and your members, unfortunately. And so you can't always share things with them. And so you sometimes feel like you're an island. And the thing about your peers is they all are in the same boat as you. And so you can always reach out to them and lean on them for things. And then a lot of times your members, you can talk to them about things, especially, you know, we all become so close with our leadership teams and we can really rely on them for a lot of things and for help with their peers. If someone on the board is, you know, not prepared or not attending meetings, or we heard some horror stories about board members who might be acting out at meetings or acting inappropriately. And a lot of times we depend on our leaders to kind of rein that in peer to peer. And then at the end of the day, I loved what Rebecca said about create the opportunity to say no. I don't say that, but I'm going to start using that. But I always say, you know, there's no, I'm not going to tell myself no. Someone else can tell me no, but I'm not going to turn myself down, you know, on something. So creating those opportunities for yourself, and you said that too, Rebecca, and I think that's so interesting that we both said that where we are, it didn't happen by coincidence or mistake. I mean, we did things to get here, and you have to remind yourself of that sometimes, that you earned it. And I think we, in this industry, or not industry, but in our roles sometimes, and maybe more as women, we have that imposter syndrome thing. And so that's another good reason to reach out to a peer, and they can knock that monkey off your back for you. So those were some of the things that we talked about at AEI, that it was a very, very good session and a lot of therapy that I think people needed. It's been a rough couple of years. So it was very good.
No, I agree. We were on a call yesterday with Mara Neal and Rebecca Donatelli, both realtors and involved highly with NAR. And they were saying just about, the question was asked, you know, what's your work-life balance and being in that position and setting your boundaries and everything. And Rebecca, you hit on it, like you were going to take that chance, and were you going to move your whole family? What was that like? And how has that really changed for your family and yourself?
Wow. Well, you know, it definitely has been a roller coaster ride, especially Katie, to your point, the last couple of years. Boy, howdy. It's been definitely something that was like twists and turns, right? And that is where it has been nice to be able to reach out to different people in the industry and just kind of check in. So that is a very important aspect, but there are so many opportunities to do that. I mean, I think as far as the organizations that I'm involved, we're always looking for those new voices to step up and figure things out. But Christy, so your question, I think, was about more like work-life balance, and that's part of it, because some of my best friends are in the industry. Like, no question. Yes, I have my own friends outside of the industry, but if you're going to really get into the details of whatever new issue is coming up, and it's probably going to be full of acronyms and like nuance, and like sometimes you need to have the group of people that you can call to do a sanity check and vent, and I definitely that. But I guess from a standpoint of my role as a CEO, I try to ensure stability through process. So I'm a huge advocate of something that I learned in my college career, which is agile project management, which was initially developed actually in Salt Lake City, where I was born and raised, but it has rolled across the entire globe, and it started in software, but is definitely a management principle, which talks about how you can ensure that certain things are happening in your organization, such as proper planning and prioritization, because there are never, in my experience, a lack of things to do. Whether that's opportunities with other organizations or just internally, or people that want to talk, or people I want to talk to, right? I'm just as much as an inhibitor towards my schedule as anybody else, because I love to talk to people, right? And sometimes I got to be short. So So an agile process talks about the way that you have conversations, again, going back to priority. And then it also instills a way to make sure that you have conversations that maybe you don't want to have, which part of it is about retrospective or reflection or a debrief, or there are a bunch of different names for it. But basically saying, hey, we said we were going to do something. Did we do it? Did we do it well? Didn't we? You know, if not, then why, right? So those can be some of the tough conversations to have, especially with a team. And that's also why, in my experience, it's more important to put it as part of a process so that it's okay to bring things up and say, okay, yeah, we meant to go here and we ended up, you know, halfway there. So what can we do next time in our next time frame to get all the way there? But it's also a time to celebrate. Hey, we said we were going to be there, but we're twice that. So then we can absolutely celebrate and say thank you and like, hey, let's keep doing whatever we just did. So anyway, process, and discipline to that process, but also just working with the right people. You know, people come and go in this industry. It's like, same person, but a different shirt, right? With the logo on the shirt. I have so many stories about somebody that I used to work with and now they're my boss or on my board of directors, or now, you know, it was employees, and I've had more than one that used to report to me and now they're like CEOs. And so there is so much opportunity to just shift roles, which is what we're talking about here. But anyway, I don't know if that answered your question, but
no, I love it. I think there's so much insight into what your world is like. And I think that like there's hesitation there. It's a big role. It's time consuming, and you guys have to do and make hard decisions and have hard conversations sometimes. But I love the processes because it sets you up for success, and you know you can go into work the next day and have that conversation and move forward and, you know, measure what you're doing and have a way to kind of justify to your board and members. Mm-hmm. I think that's important.
We talked about that last week, in fact, and a lot of the struggles that people were having, we realized it really has to do with having good policy. And so if you have things written down and you have the process, then there's no ambiguity. You're being consistent every time you apply it. And it helps things so much more if it's, whether it's a staff person or a leader, if you can point to the piece of paper, the actual policy, and show them, that really takes the heat off of you. It takes the heat off of leadership. And just, again, it's that consistency that goes a long way.
Rebecca, you talked about these past 2 years, and how did those processes have to change during COVID, and really how have they changed for the future?
Well, so before COVID, and actually it was within my first few months of moving to Chicagoland, and the weather here is no joke. I mean, just saying, like, it's known as the Windy City for other reasons, because that's about politicians or whatnot. But anyway, it is like, the snowstorms and the ice storms and everything was bringing the power up and down in our MRED office, like on the regular. And so I'm like, holy cow. And then I was like seeing my employees come to work during the horrid ice storms, frazzled and just lucky to be alive. And I'm like, okay, what are we doing? So long story short, it didn't take me too long to say, hey, we need to have a pretty robust emergency plan and the ability for everybody in our company to work from home if needed. And so we had put that in to the point where when COVID hit, employees were wanting to work more from home than come into the office by that point. And so when everything shut down, I was like, hey, you all can do, you get to work from home and you get to work from home, right? We never really went that back to what it was. There are some employees, my policy was just, you want to come to the office? Come in. You don't want to come in? Don't come in. Just get your job done. Like, mm-hmm. I don't want to babysit adults. So we were able to make the transition pretty easily. And then when it became apparent that people don't want to be in the office, we immediately began planning for how are we going to scale our organization and reach out to, as we've created jobs, not just to the Chicagoland workforce. It has been so freeing to be able to post a job opportunity and say pretty much anybody, like bring us your best and your brightest. And we've also had some staff members relocate outside of Illinois. So we've got people in California and Seattle and on the East Coast and Florida, like everywhere in between. And we also did the same thing with our board members, because a lot of them have different things that are happening across the US. And so it has definitely increased our engagement to be able to have the virtual component. There is still a real need for in-person meetings though. And so we're still working on a cycle basis or an iteration under Agile, right? To say, okay, how are we doing? Some conversations are way more productive in person. So how can we create a process where we're going to have certain dates on our calendar that everybody reports in to get the big, what we call big rocks, but like the major things done that are much better done in person. So it's just a process where we try it. And like I said earlier, maybe it worked out like we wanted, maybe it was better than we wanted, maybe it wasn't. And then we'll just use that information to do it better the next time. Anyway, that's how we've grown. It's been great. So.
Yeah, and it's nice that you guys can have talent from all over now and really benefit from that. That's amazing.
I love creating jobs. That's one of my favorite things, right? Like, it's so anyway.
I can tell by your smile. I love it. Katie, now I come from association world in my background. I was at a local. It was a little bit different because members need to come in, central lock keys. There's different things that go on. How has your world changed because of COVID, and what's it kind of look like for you guys?
Yeah, so I mean, we were all in the office full time before COVID, and March 13th, we left and packed up our stuff like our hair was on fire, and we thought we'd be back in 2 weeks, and then it was like a year later. So we, at the time, a lot of our phones are VIOP, we had Rapatoni cloud-based, like we had some systems set up that we were able to work remotely, thank goodness. But I think it forced us to be a lot more paperless, I'll say that, but I really don't use paper anymore for anything, which is awesome. But and of course, learning to use Zoom and all of those things. But we've been back in the office for a year, and I definitely think it's made all of us more flexible. And I'm working on a work from home policy, but really I'm just flexible with the staff. And if they, you know, say, I've got something I'm working on that I really just need to concentrate on, it'd be a lot easier to do at home, they can work from home. I mean, we're really flexible with that. And I agree with Rebecca, the ability to do virtual meetings has been great for our members because we cover 6 counties. So some of our members live 45 minutes away. And so for them to travel an hour and a half for an hour meeting isn't a good use of their time. So for them just to be able to jump on Zoom is so nice. I've got a member going on a global trip to Dubai this weekend, and we have our board meeting next week, and she's going to be joining us from Dubai for the board meeting. So who knew, you know, 2 years ago, I wouldn't have imagined that. But so it's wonderful. So it's been great in that regard. But I also think the whole past couple of years has made us all of us in the world, give each other more grace and understanding, and just take a minute to slow down a little. So I've really appreciated that. And I think our staff has actually gotten closer since we've been back in the office because of that, because we really, you know, we take more time to kind of like really ask people how they're doing and care about the answer, you know. so that's been a nice change too.
I agree. Now this has been amazing. Based on, and whoever wants to go first, but I'd like to hear from both of you, but based on your experience and what you knew starting out and where you are now, what do you wish you could say to yourself 10 years ago, 15 years ago, when you're first maybe getting into it?
I guess I would say, you don't have to have it all figured out. Like, I thought by the time you became a CEO, you had to know it all and be, you know, ready to answer any question or anything that came at you. And you'll never know all the things. Like, it's different every day. You never know what's coming. So I think I would say, you know, give myself more grace probably and not think I have to have it all figured out, because I never will. And I don't want to anymore. Like, I don't want to have it figured out. I want to keep being surprised. I want to keep growing and learning and being challenged. And so I think that's one of the awesome things about our industry that we all love, is there's always something new coming at us, whether it's a good thing or a bad thing, but that really forces us to keep trying to figure it out. And so that's definitely one thing. And just being open to every opportunity. I think Rebecca and I didn't realize you had that same experience of picking up and moving to advance or get the job that you wanted or whatever. And there's a lot of, that's scary. You know, there's a ton of uncertainty in that. And I'm, like I said, I was lucky to be in a position to be able to do it. And so was Rebecca, but she had more people to bring along with her. So it was more of a challenge, but don't be afraid to do those things. It will exponentially make you move further, faster in your career if you're willing to do something kind of scary and out of your comfort zone. It pays off. The dividends are just incredible. So I'm glad that I was willing and able to do that at the time to get back to where I am.
I love that. Take the risk.
Yeah.
I don't know if I could top that answer. the thing that sticks out to me is that it's people first. I mean, you're always going to have issues that come along, and you never know when the person sitting right next to you, and I think I said earlier, is going to be like somebody you report to or you're going to be working with. And, you know, this industry is great at allowing really talented people to rise up and do really cool things. So I would just say, pay attention to those that you really mesh with, and don't worry, don't take it all so seriously. I think that I used to have way more anxiety about things, and it's like, you really need to worry about getting all of the punctuation right in this document, right? Like, and then create an issue, or is it okay to like just see the bigger picture and figure out that, you know, some things are definitely important to get 100% right? And then other things, is it worth it to like do the back and forth and, you know, waste time? And like, what's the saying? Something like the perfect is the enemy of the good, like to keep that balance. Mm-hmm. I think, because I can be a total stickler on things, and then sometimes I'm like, do I really need to be that way? Like, can I be okay with, so I guess try to find the balance and just focus more on the people that you'd like to work with that are talented, and let that be part of your guide. So
I love that. We do have a few questions from the audience, and if anyone has questions, please feel free to put them in the chat. But we, of course, and this is our world, but we have a question that says, what's the strangest thing that you've had to deal with as a leader that you can share with us?
Oh my gosh.
So I keep this album on my phone, which is like really strange MLS listings and photos that people upload that just direct. You put that on the MLS and it's hilarious. So that's what immediately pops out, because like I just anyway, I can go into details. They're hilarious. I'm like, should I create like a flip book? I don't know what the copyright would be on that, but there are so many weird stories out there. This industry is so fun on like the different things that not just roll across the MLS desk, but obviously they started at the realtor level and with homeowners and consumers. And it has just been so intriguing to see how people can really do things differently, especially in different markets, because something that wouldn't really have somebody raise an eyebrow in the Chicagoland area in Utah, where it's a much different culture, was just like, yeah. Woo, right? Like, and that's honestly one of the things that during COVID that became really apparent to me at MRED is that different marketplaces totally responded differently. And so, And I know that's also something that I'm looking towards. I don't mean to get like buzzwordy or whatever, but like Web 3.0 and distributed is something that MRED is actively working on to be able to have the ability for different rules and different locations as we expand our MLS. But it's for those same reasons. It's like, what happens if one market might be, like I said, like not really well accepted in another, but anyway, so that's what jumps out in my mind. But
I'm racking my brain. I can think of some negative things that I don't really want to share, but I'm trying to think of something funny and I'm just not getting there. Sorry.
No, not a problem. What about the toughest decision you've had to make, Katie?
Oh, gosh. Staff. I recently had to let someone go who had been here for 10 years. So staff decisions are very, very tough. So I'd say that was it for me.
I bet. I think as a young professional, that would be a challenge and a fear. And okay, how am I going to deal with this? And it would be the mentors and or your peers that you reach out to and say, this is the situation I'm in. Have you been in it? Can you help me?
Exactly. And, you know, again, counting on yourself, having the confidence that you're making the right decision for the association, and then also counting on your peers and your members. I mean, I've leaned on my leadership team, let them know, and my peers were amazing. So I sort of saw this coming a few months, you know, before I did it, and kind of reached out to some of my peers and talked to them and got, you know, had them help build me up and kind of put some seeds out there for when I would need to sow them when I was looking to rehire for the position. And when I got to that point, everything just started blooming right away. So that's the awesome thing, like Rebecca was saying about this industry and our peers. We're so supportive and good to each other and generous and sharing and caring that I've always gotten help when I need it from my AE friends. So not just them, but like our vendors and other people that I reached out to were a huge, huge support to me through that process. So I guess that's something else I would have told myself 10 years ago too, is don't try to do everything by yourself. Don't, like, at all. Don't. Like, definitely reach out to people and get whatever you need from them in terms of support to get you through it.
I know we have, you know, communications directors on here. We've got all different type of staff. The communications directors are strong. I come from that world. You do as well,
yes.
Katie.
CD love.
Yeah, CD love. We have a great Facebook page, and they do support groups around RCE. And I think that's important to get involved and know that that support's there and everybody's rooting you on. I do see that in the community, and it's been the best part about being part of this industry.
Yeah.
So I don't see any other questions, but, you know, I can't thank you guys enough. This has been an awesome conversation. I hope it was inspiring to our audience. I know it was inspiring to me. I've made two new friends, and I can't wait to see you guys at some upcoming events. But really, thank you for sharing your stories. It's inspiring, and I hope to one day be in one of your shoes.
Definitely. Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Thanks, guys. Have a great day.
Thanks. Happy St. Patrick's Day.
Happy St. Patrick's Day. I love it.
Bye.